First of all, my name is Tsung-Hsien Lee, and it's truly an honor to come to Singapore and to meet so many great educators here. And personally, I'm also an educator, and also I'm an author, as people describe. And today's my talk is talking about learning, programming, and problem solving through solving algorithm problem. And it's kind of a condensed version of, let's say, my past, let's say, maybe 20 years roughly, about kind of engaging to computer science, starting from a kind of a high school student and going to college and go to the United States for PhD and become a PhD dropout and go to many software companies you guys know and working on autonomous driving software right now. But I mean, over this kind of a journey, right, I actually kind of have lots of fun of kind of learning and teaching and also kind of solving algorithm problems. Okay, so let's get started. So today is my outline. So first I will do a little bit background, and also next I will tell you about why we should learn kind of problem solving and programming. And then I will tell you how I learn this kind of thing. And at least I will tell you about my book, which is kind of my summarize of all my kind of my knowledge into that book. And I really want to use that to teach people about this more. Yeah. So this is a little bit of my background. So I came from Taiwan, and I studied in National Tsinghua University as an undergraduate student. And then after that, as you may know, many people in Taiwan, they kind of study their master immediately after the undergraduate. Unlike Singapore, because I heard about some other people saying that Singapore is like encourages students to kind of find a job immediately after undergraduate. Then after that, I went to serving compulsory military service and go to the University of Texas at Austin in the United States for my PhD since 2010 to 2012. And I didn't get my PhD. That's the reason you see that it's only kind of like 2 years roughly. And in the middle of that, I'm very fortunate. I went to Facebook in 2011. That is something like 1 year before the IPO as an intern there. And then after I dropped out my PhD, I went to Google for several years. Then I go to Uber ATG for doing autonomous driving. Then recently I go to Toyota Research, still doing the autonomous driving there. And I also published a book, I mean, in 2012. Then the last is probably my last book as well, because believe it or not, it cost me so much time, and I'm still maintaining that book right now still. And but this is kind of my greatest and kind of joy, I mean, so far, yeah. And right now I'm still being a consultant and advisor for several startups in the Silicon Valley for interviewing and hiring. And I want to mention the most important thing actually is I studied algorithm since 2003 when I was a junior student in undergraduate, and I'm still studying right now. And I also is teaching that always since this past decade. I mean, it's definitely the knowledge I like most. And since talking about the learning algorithm, I should tell you that I used to be a very avid programming contestant, which I think some teachers, you guys know, there are these kind of programming contests hosted every year, right? And I know Singapore is a very, very strong country. I know, I mean, I meet the Singapore IOI contestant when I was a coach for the Taiwan IOI contestant in several IOI International Olympic Informatics, and really impressed me. And after I was a program contestant, I retired as a program contestant. I went to become a coach for program contestant. And after a while, you retire from program contestant coach because you are too old to become a coach. Then you went to become a committee member to hosting this program contest. This is the life of a kind of program contestant. And I'm very fortunate to host the Google CodeGen, which you guys may know is the largest program contest in the world, in 2014 and 2015 in Los Angeles and Seattle. This is actually kind of, for people who can win the Google CodeGen, they are usually being kind of seen as the topmost talent in the world. They are super genius, usually, Nobel, yeah. But I'm not the one who win that. I just help them and organize that, yeah. Because I'm retired already, I mean, as a program contestant. Okay, over this year, right, I do realize one thing. Actually, let's say, as you guys know, right, everyone have a smartphone, and some people have multiple smartphones. And we know that actually the growth of data is just maybe not exponentially, maybe probably super exponential, as you may know, right? And as you may know, right, I mean, it's very important for us to kind of learn the tool and the methodology to kind of how to handle so many data. And before I hear you talking about this kind of thing, let me ask audiences one question. You heard about people talking about data and information so much recently, right? About, so do you know what's the, everyone have their own definition of data and their own definition of information. Can you guys tell me what is the difference between data and the information? Anyone? Okay, let me give you, I already spent 1 minute, yeah. But let me give you my explanation. I feel data is something something you can understand. And information that after you process data, you get something you can understand. Yeah, and we know, right, with cell phone and all this kind of thing and the laptop everyone has, right, we generate so many data every day. And especially if we consider about IoT, then we will generate way much more data in the future. So it's very important for us to, let's say, to learn the tool and the methodology to tackle this kind of thing. And here is kind of a very interesting question I would definitely would like to ask everyone. How much percent of the data, right, we human beings have generated over the past 5 years in a percent of potential, right, compared with all the data we human beings generated? Have you guys ever think about this question? Just random guess. Anyone? In terms of size, I mean.
90%.
Yeah, I think you are almost right. I mean, in fact, the answer is actually 80%. It's a kind of famous 80-20 rule, right? Because, I mean, as you know, right, I mean, long time ago, I mean, we probably only have the data, let's say, like the book in the library, right, this kind of thing, and there's not so many data and information in that. But with the past kind of 5 years, we have cell phone. Your cell phone has so many sensors in it. It's kind of constantly generating data. If some company logging that, of course, and then it generates so much data that we human beings just cannot imagine. And I think everyone knows about this kind of, let's say, the rise of deep learning, all these kind of things recently, right? And I actually have a fortune to talk with Andrew Ng, who is actually one of the founders of the deep learning, about why deep learning becomes so much powerful recently. And he actually using a very, very good analogy to me, saying that, I mean, he thinks all these deep learning algorithms you heard about, right, it's already been developed maybe 2 decades ago, like 20 or 30 years ago. So, but the difference why deep learning is working nowadays is because the amount of data we generated. So you can think about deep learning algorithm in some kind of engine we human beings already devised, like let's say 20 years ago. But we just lack of the fuel, the gasoline to fill into that. The gasoline here is actually the data to feed into that, yeah. And but with the amount of data increase, right, so I do feel that, I mean, it's like this kind of thing, right, if you are a computer, you are actually seeing this kind of figure, right, blah, 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 all kind of different alphabet symbol influx into your system every day. And I do feel that, I mean, it's actually very important to teach maybe students to learn how to problem solving and programming. And here's some kind of benefit, I think, I mean, it would be good to have learning about problem solving and programming because you will be able to perform critical thinking and decompose the problem. For example, believe it or not, I'm very kind of avid about problem solving and algorithm. So every time I play kind of a board game with my friend, I will try my very best to model this problem into an algorithm problem. And when I lose, I will go home to write some program to analyze that. And the next time I play with them, I never lose because I just optimize this kind of thing. And eventually, they don't like to play with me because I treat that too seriously, probably. And also, it's kind of learning programming, problem solving will be a good way for everyone to understand that how the virtual world behind that, right? For example, believe it or not, my mom used to think about, maybe Google only have one computer behind, right? Because I think computer is very powerful. I mean, I have no idea, I mean, why everyone of you carry so many things. But my mother even doesn't know that, I mean, because the computation nowadays, right, it's a single computer cannot just handle so many things. You need a kind of very, very complex network, distributed computing to handle this kind of thing. And also, learning kind of algorithm, in my opinion, is very, very fun. And it's also good for your brain, in my opinion, yeah, because it's kind of give you a way to think about this world, right, in a systematic way. Okay. If you learn algorithm well, I will say that you will be like this one. I mean, everyone definitely watched this movie before, it's Matrix, so I mean, you can understand this kind of thing and become a master of this kind of virtual world. Yeah. And Now I should talk about, I mean, since I talk so many about things about like how I learn algorithm, what's the benefit of learning this kind of problem solving and programming, then I should tell you that how I developed myself become this kind of thing. And as I told before, right, I was a kind of, when I was a sophomore, I actually kind of introduced by my senior about, let's say, if you want to become truly a good, maybe computer science student, how about you just participate some programming contest? Because he thinks about, let's say, kind of participating in programming contest is actually a way to kind of force you to actually not only understand the algorithm, but also force you to actually implement that. Believe it or not, I mean, think about that. I mean, you have some algorithm or idea in your head, right? And to implement that by your hand, right? You guys can see the distance from here to here, it seems pretty short, right? Physical. But for students who didn't implement this kind of thing so much, right? The distance from your head to your hand is incredibly long. I mean, you are a student, I have an idea, but I just cannot implement that. But the distance from here to here is very, very short, I mean, physically. But so that's the reason I realized, I mean, I should kind of participate in that. So I actually spent 2 summer vacation, I mean, in the school and just kind of preparing for kind of programming contest. But I don't know how the situation in Singapore, but not so many students in Taiwan, undergraduates, and they usually spend a summer vacation, chill out, I mean, I don't know, do whatever things they want. But I actually spent my 2 summer vacation just grinding these kind of things in school, I mean, in a dormitory. And the dormitory usually, I mean, like 300 people during the semester, but I probably the only one there grinding this kind of thing in the summer, maybe another friend, I mean, things like that. And I was totally kind of self-study, because I mean, we have all these kind of tool and technology on the internet nowadays. This is roughly like 2003, like almost 15 years ago, right? And during that process, right, I actually kind of mastered almost all the kind of well-known algorithms and know how to implement that into that. And I actually realized, I mean, the reason I guess kind of progress so much efficiently is actually I find this kind of feature on the internet is actually this kind of very, very quick feedback here. Because initially my goal is actually I want to, let's say, become a good computer science student, and I also want to represent my university to go to the ACN ICPC to kind of just for honor, right? I mean, if you are good at something, you just want to participate in a contest and try to meet other people, compete with them, and to see who is better, and also to meet new friends, things like that. And that's my kind of my initial goal. And also, believe it or not, I mean, the website I was using at that time is very, they have very good user interface just to kind of, I mean, tell you, oh, you are, let's say, number 15,000 among all the users in the world. And for every user, right, they have a kind of national flag in between showing it there. So I was kind of climbing the ladder of that website every day, just feeling, oh, yes, I surpassed another guy today, things like that. So I just grinding that in the dormitory for that 2 summer vacation. And it's definitely not a pain because, I mean, there's no air condition at that time. So I was kind of sweltering, I mean, in a dormitory and kind of typing program and then listening to kind of a YouTube video about, oh, what this algorithm is and implementing that. And I got some reward because, I mean, I'm become better and better. And eventually, believe it or not, I mean, when I reflect back to my career, I realized, I mean, the reason I can get so much kind of this very smooth career is I realized actually because I 2 summer vacation, I grinding this kind of thing, programming and algorithm so much. So eventually when I go to the kind of a job interview, just trivial because the question asked is usually the easier version of the problem I solved 15 years ago. Yeah. And of course, it's so much enjoyment because I mean, when I was climbing that ladder by learning this kind of algorithm and programming, I realized it just feels so good that I mean, oh yes, I see my kind of ladder rank climbing. It's kind of, I think, I don't know, have you guys heard about this kind of things called gamification, this kind of achievement system. When you're teaching students, right, I mean, you can give them some kind of gamification element, try to kind of entice them, right? I mean, you kind of not only grinding something, you also have something like a ladder, kind of like a carol in front of them, yeah. Because I know I will never be rank 1 on that kind of thing, but seeing your rank climbing, just feels so good because that number becomes small and small. Because, yeah, maybe 1 month ago I was top 1,000, but then after grinding another month, I become top 100 in the world. It just feels so good, yeah. And eventually, it's this kind of feedback. And after that, right, I just realized one thing. The reason why I can kind of grind myself is so much is because this instant feedback mechanism. Because I think everyone knows that, I mean, the best education, I mean, is probably tutoring system. For example, you have maybe your teacher just sitting in front of you, kind of tutoring you. Because the reason tutoring is so good is because, I mean, they can give you the instant feedback. Because for every time you make something wrong or something good, he can tell you, oh, this is good, this is bad. Then you can instantly get the feedback and become going to the next one. So you can, in a small amount of time, right, you will get so much feedback and you can keep improving. And another reason, I mean, I think it's actually important in education, right? When I was teaching, I was trying to build this kind of instant feedback mechanism. Because it is very, very bad for kind of a student if they make something wrong, they have no idea that it's good or right. Right. So this is kind of my kind of findings, actually. I realized, I mean, the best way of learning problem solving is just by implementing an algorithm. Because by implementing an algorithm, you will also learn how to program as well. Yeah. Then you may find this kind of interesting. This is, what is this figure, right? But well, this is actually my dormitory figure 15 years ago for that 2 summer vacation. And I want to tell you one thing. That's actually, for that 2 summer vacation, that actually is the best time in my life so far. That summer vacation is just like Singapore. It's so hot. I don't have an air conditioning in the dormitory. I just have a very crappy air fan. And I have a kind of very crappy Windows PC, internet provided by school, and a civil paper. I was kind of calculating the math when I was kind of reading a problem online and writing a program online. But I just get hooked for that 2 summer vacation. It's just so good in my life that I was grinding that, implementing algorithm, solving one problem, submit that, and eventually get some kind of notification, oh, your program works. And you solve another problem, then you will rank kind of climbing up. And every day, I was just kind of wake up maybe like 10 o'clock, solving some problem, eat some lunch, go back, solving some another problem, till dinner, and go out with my friend, eat dinner, and come back, solving another problem till maybe like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, and go to sleep, then wake up next day. And this thing's crazy. After 15 years, I look it back. And the physical condition at that time is so bad. I mean, yeah, not actually true. I mean, but the achievement feeling and all the knowledge I earned for that summer vacation just feels so good. I still can remember that joy at that time because every day I know I'm kind of making some progress. I know a new algorithm. I'm becoming a better programmer, and I can see my red rank. This kind of thing, just so good. And that is actually the best time of my life so far. I mean, yeah. Okay, then in the end, I mean, just a little bit of advice about my book because I was being invited by Chu. Let's say, I mean, I'm honored that I mean the Singapore government is actually using my book as one of the kind of a material for teaching. And this is my book, and right now we have 3 versions: C++, Java, and Python. And believe it or not, Python is the best-selling one. And yeah, it's kind of, I checked that yesterday, like top 4,439 in all the books on Amazon. It's kind of honor, in my opinion, yeah. And it's been used by some United States University as an algorithm complementary class material, yeah. And here's some kind of example of the problem we had in the book, because all the problem, right, we are talking about is a very, very kind of real-world problem, yeah. For example, how to build a search engine snippet of a search result, or for example, if you want to know how the garbage collection in Python is working, right? And it eventually can be abstract as an algorithm problem, and things like that. And this is also something we built recently. I mean, as I told you before, right, I feel that this kind of instant feedback is very important. So I built something that's like a kind of small testing framework for people who use this book. They can just kind of read the problem in the book, right? And using this package to kind of test their program is correct or not. And just test that, for example. I mean, for example, there's a problem. and just implement some program and you run it. Oh, and it says fail because some test case you didn't pass that. Then you just try to fix that problem and run it again. And you pass all the tests. This is the instant feedback I was talking about. I feel it's very, very important to, if I build some tool for people to study, it's very important to learn to kind of test by themselves and get feedback by themselves. Yeah. And I want to show some kind of funny and something kind of funny things actually. This is one of my readers, right? He actually showed me a picture. This is actually in Microsoft in the United States, the company library. On the bottom row, all of them are my book. There's so many people in Microsoft buying this book, I have no idea. And it's kind of funny in my opinion, yeah. That is the previous version, I mean, if you see the spine there, yeah. Okay, and that is actually my talk. Do you guys have any questions? Feel free to ask. Anyone? Got a question? Very, very good question. I believe every student should learn programming. Maybe even more, maybe I would say every human being should learn programming. Because I mean, I think everyone should understand. I mean, I think we all have this kind of intuition that maybe not every human being, right? They need to know, let's say, some very advanced algorithm, things like that. Because there are some of the library will be eventually packaged so well such that people just need to use it. That. I believe that, I think programming will be something like, or maybe not say programming, maybe I should say how to co-work with your AI will be a subject like math, English, literature, chemistry, physics, these kind of very, very, very fundamental subjects that every human being need to learn. In the future, I would say that, how to co-work with your AI. With your AI, yeah.
Okay, so do you think that involves programming or like some kind of computational thinking or what?
Definitely involves some kind of programming because unless we human being actually develop a kind of user interface that we can use natural language to instruct AI to do the things. Before that, we need an intermediate language which whatever intermediate language, if you write that intermediate language, right, that is actually programming to instruct AI to do things for us. But that is some kind of, maybe I would say maybe, I don't know how far away from here, but right now we don't have this kind of AI that's so powerful, right? So right now we still need to write a little bit low level, which is maybe C++, or even a little bit high level, Python, right, to build a program by ourselves. But in the future, maybe we will develop some kind of AI layer being able to develop certain level of a program by themselves. But we still need some kind of even more abstract level of a language to tell that AI to write this low level, maybe Python, by themselves. Yeah. But in the very, very future, maybe 100 years from now, we human beings only need to use a natural language to tell AI to do the things. Yeah. But not definitely not right now, I mean, yeah.
Can you
briefly
describe how different it is like preparing someone for programming interviews in teaching algorithm as compared to a normal course of algorithm in the university?
That's a good question. I think the question you're asking, I mean, preparing learning algorithm for preparing for interview versus learning this kind of thing in for what? I mean, the second thing is what? What is the second one? I mean. Yeah. Yes. So I do feel there's a difference here, but the later, right, the one that kind of a learning algorithm in class, right, I do feel that it can be modified a little bit to kind of can be easy modified a little bit to accommodate the first one for interview. For example, okay, I do meet many readers in the United States. I realize one thing is actually all of them, right, they are computer science graduate, undergraduate, or graduate before. And then they sometimes maybe complain to me about their teachers before. It's actually, I think everyone, if you ever read the Introduction to Algorithm, which is a classic textbook about algorithm, you'll realize one thing. That book is probably not for computer science students, in my opinion. That book is probably mostly for mathematics students. Yeah, they use so many symbolism, this kind of thing. And in their kind of the back of every chapter, they have this kind of problems, right? I do feel that is maybe the most important part of that book, in my opinion, as a computer science student. Because in the front of the chapter, every chapter, they use this kind of symbolism to discuss, oh, what are these things in math, in a very abstract way. But I feel most of human beings, they like the feeling that I give you an actual concrete problem, and you apply algorithm to solve that. Because as a human being, right, that's an English slang, everyone knows that when you have a hammer, right, everything like an anvil, right? And we human beings, what's the difference between human being and animal is actually we human beings know how to build a tool to apply on this kind of thing. And I realized, I mean, algorithm itself, right, is actually something that, like applied mathematics, right? You want to apply this tool to solving problem. And once you apply this tool to solving a real problem that you're facing, right, you are facing, you get, even build this kind of muscle memory in your mind, your muscle. Then you know how to apply this kind of thing there. Then you will memorize that even more further. Then I realized, I mean, in algorithm class, I did talk with some professor who used my book in the United States as an algorithm class complementary material. I told them, I mean, if you are kind of assigning homework, you probably should be using some of the problem in my book because I'm actually using a real-world problem. And, you just need to find a correct algorithm to apply that. And that will enhance the student kind of understanding and memorizing how this thing should be used. Otherwise, many of the students are like my reader, they just learn this algorithm in class. They just study algorithm for kind of, okay, because I have a midterm, final term, I memorize that kind of thing for midterm, but after midterm, I forgot about that. And it's pretty sad because for me, right, I actually apply algorithm when I play ball game, when I play mahjong with my friend, but you know, I mean, I just want to win. And it's so useful. I mean, why not using that? I mean, yeah, I can win the money, I mean, a little bit, right, things like that. I mean, and not because I write book, I just using that tool every day and just feel so good. Why not, right? So that is kind of, I feel that is kind of difference, yeah. And it could be easy modified in my opinion, yeah. Because the algorithm in the interview and versus the algorithm used in class, right? They are not so much different. They use DP, here's DP. They use shortest path here. There are shortest paths here as well, yeah. Anyone? She?
I think in a high school level, right, there are definitely some kind of fundamental data structure or very, very simple algorithm should be taught. For example, probably we don't need to teach, let's say, shortest path, which is good because shortest path is actually, I always teach shortest path to students because, I mean, when you go to airport, right, you see this kind of how long from flight from here to here, there's actually shortest path behind that, right? It's very beautiful if you understand that. But I think it's very important to teach students, for example, sorting, how to sort a bunch of things, right? Or maybe some simple data structure, let's say hash table, right? Hash table is so useful when you want to find something that you're in that collection. Now, this kind of thing to high school students, I do feel that maybe some fundamental data structure and some very, very basic algorithm that should be taught for students because they can understand, I mean, by learning that, they will understand, they will kind of appreciate how the things work behind the scenes, right? I do feel that is very important, yeah. But not all of them, to be honest to you, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.